Sebab baru start. So please remind me kalau saya terlupa record, because I need the recording untuk untuk you all view later. Right. So the notes is already in my guru. So you can refer to my guru for the notes. And I will normally letak the notes before class lah. So that you boleh tengok dulu the notes. Walaupun tahu tak siapa tengok kot kan. Download je. Kita pun sekarang baru nak buka my guru download eh. And the attendance is actually taken based on your login information eh. So I hope that everybody log in from my guru. So daripada situ nanti saya boleh dapat terus the attendance lah. Saya tak ambil attendance during class. Saya akan pergi dekat dekat my guru tu je, just take your attendance eh. Okay, so that's basically some of the housekeeping lah eh, before kita proceed. Alright, so when we talk about interest study, like I said, we are going to look at the interest rate structure and also the determinants of interest. So here we are going to look at overnight policy rate. So maybe these are the new things for you, but don't worry, I'll try my best to explain so that you all understand, so that later on, especially next week, kalau masa Menteri Kewangan kita nak present the budget next Friday ni, bila you dengar, and then you can understand a bit. Kalau tak boleh understand semua pun tak apa. Dia biasa orang malas nak dengar kan, tengok gambar je kan, tengok lukisan je, you don't want to read. Tapi for this topic at least you have some idea what are actually when we talk about interest rates apa maksud sebenarnya. Alright, so we have here interest rate structure and determinants ini benda yang kita akan tengok untuk hari ni. So why do we have to learn about interest rate? So when we talk about, put aside your, because I know you're in the fifth semester, you already learn about insurance. So ada kat situ syariah and non-syariah kan. So kita ada interest part yang kita kata these elements prohibited in Islam. But put aside the syariah part, because for this interest ni kita cerita both. Kita ada the conventional and also the interest, the Islamic part. But in general, when we talk about interest rate, these are actually the rate regarding when we have elements such as lending, borrowing, fund placement, investment, how to manage the liquidity, the cost of business and many others. So the announcement of interest rate ni biasanya is actually something that the financial market participants look forward to. And how do we actually know siapa yang decide the interest rate? So we can say that regulators set the direction of the rates based on economic scenario. So in Malaysia, the rates is actually controlled by the regulators, which is Bank Negara lah, Bank Negara Malaysia. Computer saya ni slow sikit lah. Saya pakai computer office ni, tak pakai laptop sendiri. Alright, so we can also say that businessmen also wait anxiously on any announcement of rates. It has direct impact on any major business decision. So macam kita, the household as a public, we also look forward on the interest rate level. When you want to make investment, when you want to borrow, later on when you work nanti you nak borrow, or you want to make car loan, contohnya nak beli kereta, nak beli rumah kan. So you need to know the interest rate. Okay, interest rate sekarang tinggi ke, rendah ke, bagus ke tak untuk kita buat loan, bagus ke tak untuk investment. So it is very important to understand the behavior of the interest rates. At least when you understand, you can help others and explain to them why interest rate is very important. So in other words, we can say that, okay, seperti tadi saya cakap interest rate kan. So interest rate is actually the price of borrowing money. You borrow money, this is the price that you have to pay. It's not that you borrow RM1, you have to pay back RM1. No. You borrow RM1, you have to pay RM1.2 ataupun RM1.20 contohnya. Or you borrow today, you want to pay tomorrow. Or you borrow today, you want to pay next month. So that is a different price of borrowing money. So this is actually the amount charged by a lender to a borrower. So if you borrow, the lender will charge you certain amount of money expressed as a percentage of sum borrowed. So interest rate ni kita sebut dalam bentuk percentage. Kita tak ada bagi in ringgit, kita bagi in a percentage. So to a lender, those yang bagi pinjam tu, the surplus unit interest rate is the return earned for lending his funds over a specific time period. And to the borrower, and this is the price to pay over a certain period of time, which is the interest expense. Like I said, you borrow today RM1, you want to pay next month. So you will not pay RM1 next month. You have to pay more. So because there are the various factors that affect the interest rates. So any changes in interest rate will have an opposite impact to both parties. So the lender, of course lah, kita bagi pinjam, you want a better return kan. So you prefer if the interest rate is higher. But if you are the borrower, then you prefer the rate is lower because you want to pay a lesser amount of interest. So dia ada opposite impact lah untuk both parties, eh, because when we talk about interest rate, kita ada dua parti tadi, eh. Main tak boleh pakai pula, sekejap, eh. Okay. So again, eh, kita ada two parties dekat sini. Alright, so when we talk about our interest rates, eh, we have nominal and real interest rates. What are the difference? Eh? So you need to know apa maksudnya. So when we mention about nominal interest rate, it is actually the contract interest rate charged. It is a gross rate without considering inflation rate. So as stated in the bank's letter. So when you make loans, and bank biasanya akan mention lah dalam tu how much is the interest rate, eh, in percentage without considering the inflation rate. So we also have annual percentage rate, which is the real interest rate, eh, or the actual rate change that reflect the charges in purchasing process. So nominal ni before considering inflation rate, the actual rate is the real rate is after considering the inflation rate. Eh? So this is the simple formula to calculate the real interest rate. So real interest rate, nominal interest rate minus the inflation rate. But we're not really focusing on the calculation of the interest rate itself, eh? Just to show you what is the difference between real rate and also nominal rate and inflation rate, eh? The kita kata the equation dia lah macam mana, eh? So this is the formula dia for real interest rate. So simple interest rate, ah, nak fikir macam mana how to compute the interest, the very simple interest rate formula is the interest amount which is equal to the principal, the amount that you pay or you borrow, times the number of days and also times the rate, eh? And divide by 365 days a year. Sebab interest rate ni biasanya kita ambil per annum, eh. So kalau nampak PA tu interest rate per annum. Alright, tadi kita tengok nominal versus real interest rate, eh. So it can also be fixed rate and also variable rate. So kita tengok kat sini boleh faham lah. Fixed rates means only one interest rate is quoted throughout the life of the loan. Okay, satu rate je. Let's say buat loan 10 tahun, rate is 2%. Okay, 2% throughout the 10-year period, eh. So the amount of monthly installment to be paid ni pun sama, remain constant, tak berubah, eh, because fixed rate, nama pun fix, eh. However, the fixed rate will expose bank to interest rate risk, especially when rates are volatile. So kita tengok tadi dia tag dengan inflation, eh. So kalau inflation tu, inflation rate biasanya fluctuates lah. So kalau dia fluctuate, untuk interest yang fixed ni agak rugi, eh, because bank will expose themselves to interest rate risk compared to variable rates, eh. So variable rates ni varies from one period to another. So they float, rate they float, eh, based on, okay, ni kita perkenalan dengan BR and also BLR. BR is base rate, BLR is base lending rate. Ada lagi satu OPR, overnight policy rate, eh. So for variable rates ni, the advantage is that it protects both the borrower and also the lender against the fluctuation of interest rate. So normally, charge untuk credit card dengan higher purchase, HP bukan handphone, eh. HP is higher purchase. So normally the credit card facilities and higher purchase akan gunakan variable rates. Untuk home loan, loan rumah kan sebab tempoh dia panjang. So biasanya dia akan quote pada kita fixed rate, eh. So di sini tadi, eh, bila kita kata the rate ni akan follow base rate ataupun base lending rate ni. Why? Because when the base rate increase, the rates on variable loan akan increase dan akan transfer into translate into higher monthly payment or increase in number of payments. Logik lah, eh, because harga ni fluctuate. Bila harga dia naik ataupun the interest rate tu naik, kita kena bayar lebih tinggi. So the variable rates ni minimize the interest rate risk but also may increase credit and collateral risk due to higher amount to be paid. Okay, causing borrower to have problems in settling the loan. Usually used in property-based financing. Alright, tadi kita tengok the interest rate in general. So here kita ada the reference rate. Reference rate yang digunakan di Malaysia ni ada a few types of reference rates. And ada changes, ada perubahan. You might see maybe kalau baca press release ke, or kalau tengok textbook, eh, some the old textbook that can refer pada the old rates. So the new textbook that can refer pada rate yang baru. So yang penting, eh, when we talk about reference rate ni, there are certain rates or certain types of rates, and eh, that you really have to know when we talk about reference rate. So the first one is OPR. OPR is overnight policy rate. So this is the main reference rate, eh, in determining other market rates in the financial market. It is also an indicator of the monetary policy stance of BNM. Okay, so this is how the system works. Eh. Kita nampak macam, okay, you need money, you go to bank, pergi ATM ambil duit kan. And then now sekarang semua pakai mobile banking. You pergi mana-mana nak bayar, semua pakai e-wallet je, eh. Tak payah bawa cash pun. So pada kita benda tu sangat senang. You nak transfer duit dekat kawan, nak reload semua buat dekat phone je. What we do not know is the what happened behind those transactions. Eh. Contohnya dekat sini, kita boleh nampak, eh, throughout the course of the day ni, banks will transfer money to each other. Okay, Maybank, Bank Islam, CIMB semua, they will transfer money to each other, to foreign banks, to large clients, eh, on behalf of the clients or on their own account. So end of the day, bank ni akan ada surplus ataupun shortage of funds. Logik lah kan, sebab dia transfer dan transfer sini, saya keluar duit, awak masuk duit, orang ni keluar duit, orang ni masuk duit. Eh. So dalam satu hari tu, a bank ni may have a surplus ataupun shortage of funds. So apa yang dia akan buat ialah, bank yang ada duit lebih, kita kata duit lebih lah, eh, supply of funds ni, dia akan bagi bank lain pinjam. Ataupun buat apa dia nak simpan dia banyak-banyak kan, ada surplus, dia akan pergi deposit them dekat other banks. Ataupun dia bagi bank lain tu pinjam, saya kata tadi lah, dia pergi letak deposit dekat another banks. Okay. So overnight rates ni is actually the measure of the liquidity prevailing in the economy. So sangat penting OPR ni, eh, overnight rate ni. Kalau keadaan stable, OPR ni akan stable lah. Tapi kalau tight liquidity condition, maknanya bank banyak ada shortage of money, overnight rate ni akan tinggi. So ataupun overnight rate ni akan tinggi kalau ada lack of confidence among banks. Eh. Ini semua jadi tahun 2008 dulu, lama dah lah. Okay, so OPR ni is actually issued by Bank Negara. Okay, and you can see here, eh, saya letak information daripada 2010. You can see the rate is quite high, eh, 2.25. Kita tengok OPR percentage, eh. Dia boleh naik sampai 3.25 in 2014. Tapi 2020, ah, nampak masa ni dia tinggi lagi, eh, bulan Januari 2.75. Ah, ni bila dah kita kena COVID ni, starting January tu, dia makin turun. And then the new policy Julai lagi lah, eh, masa ni ada moratorium. Kalau you all ingat, eh, you remember moratorium ni yang bank kata siapa yang hutang kereta apa semua tu tak payah bayar lagi for 6 months. So delay dulu the payment. So they revise the OPR turun sangat rendah, eh, 1.75 until now. Dia tak revise pun. OPR ni daripada 2020 masa dia turunkan 1.75 ni Julai 2020 sampai sekarang masih lagi 1.75. So we can view ada statement tak ada kat sini. Secara link dia ni. Okay. So this is the monetary policy statement. Setiap bulan, eh, jom. Setiap 3 bulan, sorry. Bank akan bersidang lah, BNM, eh. So dia akan bersidang. Share my screen sini. Tak nampak kan. Nampak PowerPoint je, okay. So bila bank meeting, eh, dia akan decide. So as at September, dia baru meeting bulan 9 hari tu, dia decide to maintain the overnight policy rate at 1.75%. So kat sini dia explain lah why do they actually maintain the rate at 1.75%. Okay, dia kata economy better progress in their vaccination program. Malaysia economy, dia kata, to curb the resurgence of COVID-19, dampen the growth momentum. So year to year, sejadinya MPC ni consider the stand monetary policy to be appropriate and accommodative. Jadi remains committed, and that is why they decide to maintain the OPR at 1.75%. So kita tunggulah lagi 3 bulan tengok macam mana, eh. Okay, back to the slide. Okay. Okay, so the OPR tadi kita dah tengok OPR ni issued by negara eh. So dia akan bermesyuarat dan dia akan decide lah sama ada dia nak maintain ataupun dia nak naikkan ataupun dia nak turunkan eh. Itu OPR eh. Decision decided by Bank Negara. Right, so the next one we have BLR. BLR is base lending rate. Right. So BLR ni is actually the minimum interest rate eh, calculated by financial institutions based on formula which takes into account the institution cost of funds and other administrative cost. Okay, ini lain bank, lainlah dia punya admin cost dia eh. Because some banks, eh, kalau kita tengok some banks, dia bangunan-bangunan bank dia, dia sewa. Some bank macam tu. Some banks, bangunan-bangunan bank dia, dia beli. So lain kan kalau dia sewa dia kena bayar sewa, kalau dia beli mungkin monthly dia kena bayar monthly lain lah. So lain admin cost untuk setiap bank eh. So BLR ni is used by commercial banks as a basis to quote for lending and advances to customers. Okay, you all kita dah tengok topik 1 hari tu, what are commercial banks, apa yang commercial banks ni buat. So contoh macam kalau when we talk about, contoh kita bagi contoh Maybank, kita lah commercial bank. Pada masa yang sama dia ada Maybank Investment kan, itu ialah investment wing dia. Dia ada Maybank Islamic, itu Islamic wing dia. Tapi as a commercial bank, commercial bank ni bagi kita service such as itulah macam apa yang kita enjoy sekarang lah, the ATM service, the loan, the financing, savings eh, untuk deposit, so ada macam-macam. Credit cards, itu semua commercial banks eh. So commercial bank perlukan BLR ni to quote for lending and advances to customers. For example, kalau kita nak letak duit dekat bank for fixed deposit contohnya, okay, dia quote lah, and this is the percentage untuk fixed deposit. Ataupun kita nak buat loan kereta, nak beli kereta baru, kita buat loan. Dia akan bagi kita the best rate based on BLR. Dia bukan main petik je rate apa dia nak bagi kan, based on BLR. And BLR almost always the same amongst major banks. So tak boleh nak lain sangat lah eh, because nanti dia kalau lain pun sikit je, because kadang-kadang tak tahu lah you pernah dengar ke tak eh, kadang, okay nak beli kereta loan, kereta bank mana interest bagus sekarang, okay, ada kata, okay pergilah RHB, RHB bagi 2% lah contohnya, pergilah Maybank, Maybank bagi 1.9%. So dia boleh, kita boleh negotiate dekat situ, tapi the BLR ni biasanya almost the same, sebab so, tu beza interest tu tak banyak sangat eh. Okay, how do we derive at BLR ni? Eh? So derive ni is BLR is derived by taking into account the funding cost, administrative cost, and also the profit margin for banks. Okay, ini kira sejarah sikit lah, eh, macam mana bank boleh come up dengan BLR. So kat sini ada clipboard ni, saya tak letak apa maksud dia. Eh. Dia ialah London Interbank Rate. So in this case, eh, funding cost ni maksudnya 3-month rate average lah. So ini cerita lama lah, 1998 ni economic situation masa tu recession, so the formula was revised. So nak dapat BLR ni made by banks at almost the same time. So BLR does not adjust on any regular basis, dan biasanya BLR ni dia adjust ikut adjustment of OPR yang tadi kan. So September baru ni Bank Negara dah bagi new OPR rate which is 1.75%. Jadi BLR ni dia adjust lah, dia adjust based on the new OPR rate tu. So dia bukan adjust selalu lah, so every 3 months dia akan bertukar. But for the past 1 year tak ada apa yang berubah, OPR pun sama, so BLR pun dia berubah pun sikit je lah. Eh. Okay, this is how kita calculate BLR. So kalau dulu ada BNM intervention rate eh. Ini calculation dulu lah, old calculation tak payah tengok. So now kita pakai yang ni. BLR, that is why we need the OPR tu. OPR, that's why tadi kalau saya kata BLR dan among bank sama je. Sebab pun OPR semua pakai sama. OPR now 1.75. Itulah basis untuk dia calculate BLR. So certain bank dia guna OPR tu, dia plus minus the cost structure. Bank yang bagus, yang boleh manage cost yang tinggi, mungkin dia boleh letak rendah je cost structure dia. Sebab tu rate dia boleh jadi rendah kalau nak pinjam. Certain bank yang mana cost dia mungkin tinggi, BLR akan tinggi sikit sebab the cost dia lebih tinggi. Because the basis is OPR. Contoh kalau OPR 1.75, tambahlah berapa persen kat sini. So beza tak banyak. Eh. This is the BLR from 2000 to 2010. Nampak 2010 tinggi eh. Kita punya BLR tinggi eh. Ni masa kita pakai BLR. So here kita boleh nampak lah the highest BLR pernah jadi 12% eh, back in 1998 and the lowest is in year 2009 eh, 5.5%. So bila ada BLR macam ni nampak tak cara kira BLR macam ni eh? Based on OPR plus minus. Kau suka hati je nak tambah tolak berapa depending on the bank's cost structure. Tak berapa nak apa ni transparent kan because we don't know. Macam bank RHB contohnya BLR dia 3%. Okay, 3% kita tahu OPR 1.75 tak berubah. OPR sama. So cost structure dia sekian-sekian. So kan pergi dekat CIMB BLR dia 5%. Kenapa 5%? OPR 1.75 je, kenapa BLR dia tinggi? Ha, kos dia tinggi. Macam mana dia dapat kos tinggi? We don't know eh. Not that transparent. So, apa yang berlaku is, okay, because of the inflation rate, because of to strengthen the economic growth, so the government think that, oh, kena revise the BLR ni. So, in 2015, nampak eh, the reason why, because dia kata tadi, it's not really transparent eh. So, in 2015, baru ni je, so they introduce base rate. Banyak guru pernah pakai kan. So tadi OPR, overnight policy rate. And then dulu kita ada BLR, base lending rate. So in 2015, the government come up with, bank negara lah, come up with a new rate, which is base rate. So introduce the base rate. And it is said that base rate is more transparent and based on borrower's credit risk. Yang tadi tu based on the bank's operation kan. Ataupun kita kata tadi based on bank's cost structure. Bank punya cost structure, not the customer. The bank's punya cost structure kan, which is not really transparent. Lain bank lain dia punya structure. So they come out, the bank negara come out with BR base rate based on borrower's credit risk. Lagi bagus kan, better. More market driven and provide a more efficient pricing practice for retail loans. Okay, the base rate ni financial institution benchmark cost of funds and considering the SRR eh, as opposed to BLR where bank calculate by taking into consideration the institution's cost of funds and other administrative costs. So like I said, the administrative cost it can be very different from one bank to another. So by using the base rate ni, by using the statutory reserve requirement ni, it is more transparent. So, masih tertinggal. Alright, so boleh eh, because the base rate ni is actually how the bank calculated. The base rate ni dia ambil statutory reserve requirement instead of ambil base lending rate eh. So, to get the effective lending rates, which is the best, the base rate eh, which is lower than the BLR. Jadi ditambah pula specific rate equivalent to the level of risk of borrower. For example, base rate plus 1%. Because remember eh, dia pergi kepada borrower's credit risk. Dia tengok borrower. Kalau borrower tu credit risk dia low, then dia boleh pinjam banyak. Boleh bagi dia interest rate yang low. Tapi kalau the borrower's credit risk tu tinggi eh, borrower ni pernah tak bayar loan lah apalah. So the bank might charge higher interest rate eh. So nampak lebih transparent lah. Because it depends on the borrower, bukan on the bank's punya administrative cost eh. So currently the base rate for local commercial banks is conventional eh, bukan Islamic is between 3 to 4.47% and the BLR is between 6.65 to 7.15. So tinggi lah eh, so, BLR ni. Because last time it used to say that there used to be a claim eh, saying that banks easily manipulate the BLR. Sebelum ada base rate ni eh. So now bila dah ada base rate ni, then lebih transparent lah. Dia not easily manipulated eh. So this is the example of base rate yang ada dekat Malaysia ni based on banks eh. So I listed down here information based on banks. So here, for example, base rate for Affin 2.7, 2.57, 2.6 eh. Macam Bangkok Bank tinggi eh. Dia punya base rate dia. Macam Maybank rendah. So again eh, depending on the banks tu punya kita kata affordability of the bank, eh? Bank yang perform well biasanya base rate dia lebih rendah, eh? Alright, ini termasuk dengan Islamic Financial Institution. So Islamic Financial Institution pun dia ada base rate dia juga. So the profit rate dia kan, kalau if you know for Islamic banks, dia tak kata interest, eh? Kita ada profit sharing, eh? For example, in the case of investment ataupun savings, kita ada profit sharing, eh? In terms of financing, dia panggil financing lah, dia bukan borrowing kan, dia financing. So this is the rate for Islamic Financial Institution. Again, eh, Maybank memang rendah. And this is for DFI, Harian Rakyat, Agrobank and BSN. Okay. Okay, what are the relationship between these rates? Eh? So the relationship between these rates are very strong, eh? Because any changes in one will have impact on another. So can you imagine that everything start with OPR? So now OPR rendah 1.75. OPR rendah, so base rate ataupun BLR akan jadi tak berapa nak tinggi lah. So if the OPR is higher, eh, when the BNM increase the OPR, so OPR tu naik je, yang lain tu of course akan naik, eh. And also the interbank rates, eh. Interbank rates ni, kita ada interbank rates juga. Average rate bank lend and borrow money among themselves in the financial system. Saya kata tadi lah, that during a day punya transaction tu, sometimes certain bank dia ada surplus kan, ada surplus dia pergi deposit dekat bank lain ataupun dia bagi bank lain pinjam. Bank yang tak cukup, yang tiba-tiba ada deficit tu, so dia kan borrow, eh, using the OPR tu. Okay, this is, I get this from Bank Islam, ni lama punya, eh. So this is the example lah, kalau kita nak tengok macam mana how does actually the interest rate works, eh. Contoh-contoh, eh. Dia punya advertisement dia, of course lah kan, this is for personal financing, personal loan, eh. So reduce your monthly commitment and save more, katanya. Right. So this is the salary, this is the allowance, blah blah blah, ini total income. Ini bayar tax, tolak. Ini new salary dia, okay. Dia bagi payslip lah, because this is what you need, eh, in order for you to borrow money from bank. So dia advertise dekat sini. Enjoy low financing rates. Financing amount up to 200,000. Tenure up to 10 years. Fast approval. Biasanya so promotion kan. Account full protection. Doorstep banking service. So this is the monthly installment rate for personal financing. So for personal financing ni, this is normal, eh, untuk interest rate dia yang agak tinggi. Personal loan memang rate dia agak tinggi. Contoh kat sini, eh, pinjam RM10,000. Bayar balik 1 tahun. Sebulan RM800. Lagi lama bayar, lagi kurang amount. Tapi interest rate dia sama yang ni. Dia bagi base rate plus 2.12. Lagi lama pinjam, lagi tinggi interest dia. Kan kita boleh faham, eh? Because lagi lama tempoh dia, lagi tinggilah the interest rate risk tu kan. Tinggi risk untuk maybe the borrower ni tak bayar. That is why the rate dia makin tinggi. So this is the promotion lah, dia bagi illustration, eh, based on current base rate. So this is where the banks use the base rate yang kita belajar yang tadi lah, eh, how do banks come up with the base rate ni. Okay. Alright, this is the relationship between rates. Macam tadi saya kata, eh, increase in interbank rates ni will change the direction on the OPR, base rate and also BLR, and finally the lending rate. So lending rates ni is the rate quoted by bank to customer for various types of financing. Ni yang saya kata tadi lah, when you want to borrow, when you want to buy a new car, nak buat loan dekat bank, so bank akan bagi satu rate. Nak buat business, nak buat personal financing kan, macam tadi kan, yang ni home, apa ni, home loan pula, personal loan, this is the rate yang bank akan bagi. Macam mana dia dapat rate ni? Okay, so the rate ni bergantung kepada ni lah, OPR and also the base rate, eh. So interbank rates ni, kalau dia naik, OPR pun naik, so base rate pun naik, and so dia positive relationship, eh, lending rate pun akan naik. Kalau interbank rate ni rendah, OPR pun macam rendah, so base rate pun boleh jadi rendah. So kalau OPR ni tinggi, OPR ni dia based on bank interbank, eh, OPR ni tinggi, sini akan tinggi. Jadi lending rate untuk customer yang kita nak dapat rate untuk buat pinjaman tu pun akan jadi tinggi. Sebab dia, remember, dia positive relationship. So very easy lah, kita boleh nampak satu rate ni naik, lain semua akan naik, eh. Because kalau OPR dah tinggi, bank terpaksa charge tinggi lah kan. OPR pun dah tinggi, takkan dia nak charge kat kita rendah, eh. Okay, ha, dah banyak ni OPR, BLR dengan base rate. Ada lagi satu yang baru. I introduce you the new one. New one ni belum take place lagi. Will take place next year, August 2022. Dia panggil SBR pula. Tadi BR je. Tadi Baskin Robbins je. Sekarang SBR pula. Standardized Base Rate. Tukar lagi. Next year. Dia revise. Reference Rate Framework ni. Bank Negara revise. Akan ada new standardized base rate will be used as common reference rate for all financial institutions for the new retail floating rate loans. Okay, dia akan link solely to OPR je, which is determined by the monetary policy committee. Okay, kalau tadi base rate tu dia boleh ambil base rate kan, dia boleh tak nak guna OPR, dia boleh ambil base rate, but now SBR dia akan based on OPR sahaja. So other components, borrow credit risk apa semua ni will be continue to be reflected in the spread above the standardized base rate. So lebih transparent. I think if you go back to the history, kenapa base rate ataupun the lending rate ni berubah-ubah, because of to improve the comparability and to make it more transparent to consumers. Because sometimes you wonder kan, kenapa bank tu tinggi, kenapa bank ni rendah. So bila ada standardized base rate ni, but they guarantee that they will have no impact on the effective lending rates of retail loans. Untuk retail loan masih lagi ikut base rate and also BLR. So after the, macam sekarang tak ada apa-apa perubahan lah because belum lagi August 2022. But after the effective date ni, base rate and BLR ni akan ikut lah SBR ni. Whatever adjustment yang ada, base rate akan ikut. Tapi ni cerita next year lah. And financial institutions will still continue to display their base rate and BLR. Walaupun dah ada SBR ni, they still have to tunjukkan the base rate. And new borrowers should also be largely unaffected. Nah, sebab dia kata dekat sini, effective lending rates for new borrower would continue to be competitively determined and influenced by multiple factors. Contoh, nanti kita tengok lah what are the factors that determine the interest rates tu. Okay. So this is how they come up with SBR. So SBR shall be set as SBR equal to benchmark rate. So benchmark rate ni mana dapat? Based on OPR. OPR. So lending and financing rate equal to SBR plus spread. Kita tak duduk dalam kotak pula ini. Should be in box ni. The formula ni. Right, tapi tak ada apalah, the information is correct, just that dia tak duduk dalam box je. And so here means the shift towards the SBR ni does not represent change in monetary policy lah of Bank Negara Malaysia. Okay, that's basically some information on the standardized base rate and also base lending rate. So you all dah berkenalan dengan the different types of rate ni. And we also know that the interest rate ni they move in a positive direction with the OPR base rate, base lending rate and also the interbank rates. Okay, next one kita ada loanable funds theory. Okay, this is a theory that states that the interest rate are directly correlated to the fluctuating supply of funds. Dia duit ni macam barang juga lah, ada demand and supply kan. So the interest rate directly correlated. So according to this theory, with the point at where the supply and demand lines intersect, it is called the equilibrium or market clearing interest rate. So interest rate ni dia akan macam ni lah. Nanti kita tengok the graph dia. So dia akan jadi macam ni. This is the supply. This is the demand and all the volume of credit borrowing cost ni. And this is the equilibrium. Macam you all belajar economics lah, demand supply the equilibrium. So this is the market interest rate. So demand for credit is equal to supply of credit. Right. So how do we get this E dekat equilibrium ni? So these are the factors yang or the demands that give rise to loanable funds theory ni. So loanable funds, why do we, there's a demand for funds, for household demand, for business demand, for government demand, foreign demand and also aggregate demand. So ini pun logik je lah, the demand for loanable funds, eh, household perlukan, business perlukan, eh, the government pun perlukan. Okay, so this is also how the interest move, right? So there will be a shift in demand and supply. So bila ada shift demand and supply, jadilah fluctuation lah dekat equilibrium ni. Daripada titik ni, dia boleh pergi ke sana, dia boleh pergi ke belakang, right? Alright, now let's look at the factors that affect the interest rates. Eh? Tadi kita dah tengok OPR. Sorry. Sorry, Jensen, saya kena kita tingkap. Right, eh? So just now we look at the different types of interest rates, eh? The base rate, the OPR, and also the base lending rate too. Now we want to know what are the factors that affect the interest rates, eh? Because we know that kita kata depend on the consumers, kita kata consumers punya factor, eh? Tadi kita nak tengok lah. So if we're talking about the consumers factor, is that the only factor that affect the interest rates, eh? So we have five factors, eh, that affect the interest rate. So this is very important factors. Memang you all kena tahu lah, eh? So the first factor kita tengok yang tengah dulu is inflation. I think everybody knows about inflation, kan? So the higher the inflation, the higher would be the interest rate. Inflation maksudnya harga barang semua naik, so the interest rate for sure akan naik, eh. So here when inflation arise, atau inflation ada, so the kita kata the investor, eh, needs higher return. Investor needs a higher return to compensate for their cost of consumption. So macam tadi lah, eh, so the lender yang bagi pinjam duit ni of course nak interest yang tinggi, eh, sebab nak compensate cost dia tu. And the borrower nak yang rendah, eh, tapi sebab because of the inflation, they have to pay a higher price. So that is inflation. So kita kata ni positive relationship lah. Tinggi inflation, tinggilah interest rate. Next, kita ada default risk. Okay? What is default risk? So default risk is a risk that the issuer will not pay the principal and also the interest on a timely basis. Eh? Default. Dia tak boleh nak bayar. So there is always a risk, eh, if the borrower will not be able to pay the amount borrowed in the specified time. So what happened in this case is that lagi tinggi the default risk, lagi tinggi the interest will be. Eh? Sebab tu sometimes kan you see the advertisement, eh, which is quite misleading lah. Dia kata bank blacklist pun still boleh buat loan. Maksud bank blacklist tu sebab bila orang ni dah buat pinjaman and tak boleh bayar, so the bank blacklist dah. Ha, tapi ada lagi certain institution, along ataupun ke, dia kata boleh pinjam juga walaupun bank dah blacklist. Because itu blacklist tu dah masuk dalam kategori default lah, dia tak boleh nak bayar. Dia tak boleh nak bayar the interest and also the principal. So ini pun sama macam inflation. The higher the default risk, positive relationship, eh, the higher the default risk, the higher the interest risk. Okay, time to maturity. Time to maturity ni maksudnya the length of time, eh, the length of time, the security ataupun the dia kata the loan, eh, will mature. So the longer the time, the higher would be interest rate. Ingat tadi loan yang personal loan tadi kan, kalau nak pinjam lagi lama, lagi tinggi interest rate dia. Ha, ini contohnya lah, time to maturity, eh, saya patah balik sikit tadi. Ha, kan? Bayar dalam masa 3 tahun, 6% dia interest dia. Bayar dalam masa 10 tahun, 7.05%. So this is the time to maturity risk. Lagi lama pinjam, lagi lama tempoh dia, eh, the longer the time period, the higher the interest would be, eh. Because time to maturity maksudnya lagi lama kena bayar installment lah, eh. Lagi lama bayar installment, lagi higher the risk. And then kita ada liquidity. Liquidity ni means whether the security is easily sold, eh, at expected price. So highly liquid asset ni carry low risk, eh. So bila low risk, high liquidity, maknanya lagi liquid, lagi senang kita jual, eh. Lagi senang kita jual dan dapat balik cash. So highly liquid asset, lagi rendah risk dia. So ini opposite direction. Kalau 1, 2, 3 tadi positif, eh. Inflation naik, interest naik, default risk naik, interest naik, masa naik, interest naik, liquidity tak. Liquidity naik, interest turun. Okay? And interest rate, real interest rate, tadi kita dah tengok kan, the real interest rate is the percentage change in the buying power of a dollar ni. So, they measure the consumer punya preference time untuk consume today ataupun consume later. So, yang ni pun sama jugalah. Lagi tinggi, lagi tinggi interest rate, real interest rate, lagi tinggi the interest rate. So, satu ni je lah yang opposite direction yang lain semua positive relationship kan, the level, because here we are talking about the level of interest rate. So ini semua lagi tinggi, lagi tinggi yang ini. Kecuali liquidity. Okay, lagi tinggi liquidity, lagi rendah level of interest rate. Kan? So saya dah explain dekat sini, the rest ni sama je explanation ni kan, you can read. Okay, so inflation positive, real interest rate pun positif juga kan. Higher preference to consume today, the higher will be the real interest rate. Default risk tadi yang the issuer will not pay the interest lah. So the higher chances of default, the higher is the interest rate. Liquidity yang easily sold tadi, highly liquid asset carries lower interest rate. Time to maturity, again the length of time kan. The longer the maturity dates, the higher the interest. Rate eh? Oh, tu je, for interest. Any question tak? Saya cakap kena lawan bunyi hujan, hujan lebat dah sini. Do you have any question for interest rate? Tak ada? Tak ada, boleh faham eh?
Boleh, boleh, boleh.
Okay, so untuk dia topik yang first two topics ni, this the introduction yang macam kita buat last week tu, and this is the interest rate. So from topic three onwards nanti kita dah cerita benda lain dah. This is just for you to understand the concept of interest rate, because untuk topic three kita akan buat money market lah, yang tu lebih interesting lah. For the next, for the future topics ni kita akan ada money market, kita ada foreign market, kita ada offshore market, kita ada derivative, tu semua lagi interesting lah compared to interest rate ni. Sebab ini lebih kepada policy interest rate ni, because we do not control the interest rate. So negara yang keluarkan policy, keluarkan the OPR, keluarkan the base rate, keluarkan juga the BLR, and also yang baru nanti akan ada standardized base rate. Ini semua policy. So we need to know and also understand, especially the determinants of interest rate lah. So in your case, I think yang important satu, of course, you have to understand the different types of interest too. And also here, the factors affecting the interest rates. Okay. I did not prepare any quiz for today, but nanti saya akan inform dekat group lah kalau saya dah prepare for, because normally I will have a quiz every end of the topic. So habis topik ni kita akan buat quiz, but maybe for this one, I hope by this week everybody dah settle down. Sebab saya tengok last week ada lagi keluar masuk tukar guru kan. So I hope this week semua dah settle down, then we can start with our quiz properly lah nanti. You all punya jadual semua okey ke? Ada clash lagi tak?
Semua okey dah
tu.
Semua dah okey dah? Semua dah bertenang, dah settle down lah eh?
Dah.
Okay, dah settle down. Very good. So now I will go back to our quiz one. Kita nak tengok jawapan dia sikit. So I think the highest, I think 7, good, 7 over 10. Saya bagi 10 soalan je. Macam ni. Just the quiz. Tak tahu lah, sebab bila tengok video kan, ada things yang memang not covered in the, bukanlah not covered, just bagi, saya bagi list contoh list of banks kan, saya just bagi list je. Tapi tak ada letak dekat situ. What is exactly the answer? Q Right. So boleh nampak screen saya eh? Saya tak tahu macam mana
Boleh
nak
tak
share
ya?
kat sini sebab dia tak ada. This
Boleh
is
tak?
this is my view eh untuk quiz setup ni. So jawapan terus ada nampak dekat sini dah. Alright, so the first question, saya tak tengok because I can easily see your results dekat sini lah. Nak tengok result semua orang ke? Tengok. Boleh, saya nak tunjuk kat sini eh. So from here, I can see lah siapa yang dah buat, siapa yang belum buat. So you all good me eh. So this is all your score. Ada yang appear dua kali eh. Saya tak tahu kenapa because sometimes you tak boleh nak attempt. So dia keluar tak ada lah. Tapi ni dah ada dua. So adalah. So you can see here, I think the highest is 7 eh. Okay, so let's look at the question. Alright, so for question one, the question is which of the following institutions is classified as a non-bank financial intermediary? So this semua bank lah. CIMB, Investment and also Afin Islamic Bank eh. Tapi Agro Bank dia masuk dalam kategori non-bank eh. Dia development financial institution eh. So that is for question one. Question two, not prescribed under the DFI. Lain semua under DFI eh. Bank Perusahaan Kecil Sederhana, Exim Bank, Bank Pembangunan kecuali FIDF. Okay, soalan pun saya bagi multiple choice je. Question three, services rendered by a commercial bank except commercial bank tak buat submission eh. Tak buat submission untuk equity and bond issuance to the Securities Commission. Custody services, safe deposit and share custody. Ini commercial bank buat. Trade financing facilities, letter of credit. Ini commercial bank buat eh. Retail banking service such as acceptance of deposit. So yang kita sebagai customer ni, kita pergi simpan duit fixed deposit lah, savings lah. Itu semua retail eh. Dia panggil retail. Tapi commercial bank don't perform submission on equity and bond issuance to the SE. Ini perform by investment bank. So dia tanya kat sini service by commercial bank. Question 4, which of these institutions supported government initiative in the strategic sector? Okay, ni saya rasa semua betul. Ni eh, DFI eh. Development Financial Institutions. Foreign ownership. Okay, yang ni kena Google sikit lah. Aku nak dapat jawapan dia eh. Ni semua foreign ownership ni Allianz Life Insurance. Yang lain ni semua Malaysia punya. Allianz ni foreign eh. Not core activities of an investment bank. Investment bank ini semua dibuat kecuali retail. Walaupun dia buat investment advisory, saya tahu eh, ini agak confusing kalau you baca notes kan. Investment bank buat juga investment advisory. Tapi dia untuk corporate eh, bukan untuk retail. Retail, whatever retail tu semua done by commercial bank. So not core activities of investment bank is retail investment advisory. Question 7. Which of the following contract is not primarily used in financing activities in Islamic banks in Malaysia? Okay, soalan dia tanya financing. Mudharabah ni bukan untuk financing. Mudharabah ni profit sharing eh, untuk savings ataupun investment. Yang lain-lain semua untuk financing. Dia pasal loan eh. Baina, Tijarah, Mudharabah. Except for Mudharabah. Walaupun nama macam dekat-dekat dia kan, Mudharabah bukan untuk financing eh. Mudharabah untuk investment. Besides life insurance, which of the following is type of insurance company in Malaysia? Yang ni belajar semester lepas or semester before eh. So kita semua ada life and general. Ini semua masuk dalam general kan. Yang nak jawab ini pula. This is just to give you to get you confused too. Type of insurance company, general insurance company, whereby all these three ni masuk dalam general insurance. Okay, boleh tengok jawapan nampak macam senang semua kan? Salah-salah. Which of the following is a full-fledged foreign Islamic bank? Full-fledged maksudnya dia memang fully owned by foreign eh, which is Kuwait Finance House. Yang ni semua ni ada Malaysia pun eh. Last one, prior to investment banks, this bank are known as merchant banks. So dulu eh, dia tak panggil investment bank. Dia panggil merchant bank. Alright, any question tak for this quiz? Nak ni quiz bermain je ni. So, lepas ni quiz will be done here juga eh. That's why kalau you ada isu nak jawab quiz ni, saya bagi masa pun tak lama eh. For this one, you will have 20 minutes je. Tapi saya buka sampai seminggu. But maybe for next quizzes, it will be 2-3 days je lah. Tak adalah sampai 1 week eh. Untuk jawab the quiz tu. Saya dah kena menjerit lah melawan bulu hujan. Well, have any questions tak untuk hari ni? And for this class, eh, if you have no issue to switch on your camera, please do so. Kalau internet tak kuat nak on camera, then tak apalah. Eh. But if you have no problem, then you can switch off class. Kita pun tak ramai. Eh. At least I can see some of you. Berapa orang je pun yang ada ni. Ada soalan tak? Yes. If you happen to be in campus and you want to come and see me, boleh buat appointment lah eh. Walaupun saya tak dalam dalam untuk kita jumpa face to face. And another thing is that untuk subjek ni, kita tak ada textbook eh. Saya dalam proses, mereka sempat siap lah, tapi tak siap sebenarnya. Saya dalam proses menulis the module eh, together with the question untuk subjek ni. Tapi sebab tak berjaya menyiapkan, so I cannot share with you. But I really hope that notes yang saya buat ni memang tak berapa nak cukup lah for you. Eh. You need to cuba cari jugalah buku-buku ataupun you can find especially the books lah. Eh. Boleh cari buku-buku kalau nak baca eh, buku on financial market institution. Okay, so you can Google je. Ini ada je, ada e-book ada, and then the topics pun banyak online je eh, so boleh cuba carilah. But for a specific textbook kita memang tak ada, sebab dekat Malaysia ni pun memang tak ada buku pasal Malaysian financial market, memang tak ada. So saya ingatkan sempat saya buat eh, saya akan share with you, tapi nampaknya tak sempat. Ada soalan tak? Oh, lagi satu simple nak bagi tahu eh, saya biasa buat kelas, saya tak break tau. Saya jalan terus je. Tapi kelas kita memang takkan lama lah. Paling lama pun 1 jam 40 minit macam tu. Tak apa eh, macam tu eh.
Boleh, Doktor.
Okay. So, kita memang akan habis before 5. So, macam saya kata tadi lah, kelas saya paling lama pun 1 jam 45 je macam tu. And biasanya saya akan bagi kerja lah untuk semua eh. But for this week, untuk your task 1 tu, nanti saya edit dulu and then I will upload to my guru. And you can tengok dulu lah. The task cumanya saya tengah fikir, you all ada 18 orang kan. 18 orang. Mungkin 6 orang pula. 6 grup je lah kot dalam grup ni eh. 3 in a group. Satu kumpulan 3 orang. Saya perlukan 6 grup sebab nanti you can form your own group. 3 orang satu grup eh. Dan saya nak setiap grup tu cari bank untuk research nanti. So dalam 6 group ni kita boleh discuss dekat WhatsApp group pun tak apa nanti eh. Saya tak nak ada yang buat bank yang samalah. So you have to have 6 different banks untuk buat assignment ni. Okay. It can be local bank, it can also be foreign bank. So you boleh Google tengok lah eh. Dalam notes yang last week saya dah share local and foreign bank. So boleh pilih lah bank mana you nak. Local boleh, foreign bank pun boleh. And you have to stick with that bank throughout the assignments eh. Sebab ada 3 assignments, saya kata tadi ada 3. You akan contohnya, let's say you choose public bank. So your public bank ni akan digunakan untuk assignment 1, assignment 2 and also assignment 3. Tak main tak aci tukar bank eh. Pilih satu betul-betul. And then let us know so that tak ada yang ambil bank yang sama for this assignment. And nanti saya I will discuss with you the task lah. Boleh kan macam tu?
Boleh, Doktor.
Alright. So if you have no question, saya dah tak larang Aisyah to lawan bunyi hujan, eh, you openkan bunyi hujan lebat kan? So I think that's all for today and I will see you next week. Kalau ada apa-apa information update, saya akan share di WhatsApp group lah. So I hope everybody is already in our WhatsApp group, eh. Kalau belum, please join. So semua info akan saya share di WhatsApp group. Alright, itu sahaja untuk hari ini.
Okay, thank you, Doktor.
Alright, thank you, Doktor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Okay.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you. All right.